So we are at the offices of Paul Tudor Jones, a legendary investor. Of course, he's looking at me. He hates when I say legendary, but the legendary investor is here, of course. He also founded Robinhood, founded Just Capital, and we have a lot to talk to you about this morning, including these new rankings from Just Capital. I want to get to that. We're going to do a two-part interview. One, effectively, I want to talk about Just Capital. The other, I want to talk about the markets and where things are at. And I know you have a bold call on maybe what the Fed is going to do, and we're going to get to that in just a bit. But before we even just hit Just Capital for a second, just give me a taste. What is your thought? In the past couple of weeks, the volatility has been enormous. What are you doing with your money? What are you thinking about these markets?
I think we're going to see a lot more of what we just saw, which is a lot more volatility. You know, it's really easy to say I'm really bullish, I'm really bearish. I kind of see a two-sided market. I think in the next year we'll be, from where we are today, 10 down and 10 up.
10 down and 10 up.
Both sides of it, at least 10% either way, maybe 15 either way, well, from where we are right
now. Let's talk about all of that. We're going to put a pin in that for a second and talk about that in a moment because I want to understand how you position yourself for that, if that is the case. But I also want to talk about Just Capital this morning. You're releasing new rankings for 2018. This is your effort, effectively, to rank companies based on the way the public perceives these businesses, and you have an ETF out that you launched. We talked about it last time in the spring. We should say that that ETF, I think, is down about 5%, actually pretty much matching where the S&P was since that began.
That's about right. It's outperformed the S&P and the Russell 1000 for seven straight quarters, though. So I outperformed the Russell 1000, I think the S&P for seven straight quarters.
Okay, but let's talk about, though, this ranking. Top of the list is Microsoft, and it's a very tech-heavy list at the top this year. What was the big surprise and difference when you made the rankings this year?
Oh, there weren't that many. There weren't that many changes. We had 33 new companies move into the Just 100. In the top five, we had Alphabet move into the top five. It is tech-heavy because tech does such a great job on worker pay, and that's our number one metric. Our metric's the most important. The American public says the most important thing for justice for a company is 25% worker pay, 18% customers, 15% products. So, and what's so interesting about that is that 25% for workers and 18% for customers, it's so different when you think about what the public's telling us. It's about people, right? It's about workers, and it's about customers, it's about people, and yet in Wall Street we manage companies always manage for profit. So there's a big difference there.
But here's the thing I don't understand. If Jeff Bezos was making this list, I assume he would put product at the top. You'd either put customer or product at the top before you get to worker. At some point you'd want leadership and shareholders. And I'm not discounting the environment or communities or jobs or all these other issues, but clearly, if you don't have the product and the customer part right, you probably don't have a business.
Right. And if you don't have really well incentivized, smart, engaged workers, you're not going to have a product and you're not going to have customers. So I don't think none of this is black or white. It's all shades of gray. It all works into this wonderful thing called capitalism. And, of course, the reason that we started Just Capital was because we want to make capitalism work for all. We're trying through the private sector, which, you know, 18 trillion, four times the size of the public sector, 40 times the size of philanthropy. We're trying to change the most important thing in all our lives, which is our work, in a way that's going to give us a society that's more sustainable. Here's something that's a little scary. There was a poll recently conducted that 51% of millennials between 18 and 29 are opposed to capitalism. You're going to be 20 years from now doing this from Havana unless we change the way that capitalism works right now, because we're leaving too many behind, right? In the past 40 years, we've had an 80% increase in worker productivity, but they've only shared in 10% of that. So we have to change. We have to modernize, or this great system that we have is not going to continue as we know it now.
Okay, so explain this, though. So number three on the list, you mentioned it earlier, is Alphabet.
Right.
Alphabet's also come in the news because of data protection issues and all sorts of other things. How does that then rank in this?
Right. So remember, something like data privacy is going to be a component of probably we collect over 80 different subsets of components that go into our overall ranking, and I forget how many hundreds of thousands of different data streams. So it's just one small part. They do a great job on worker pay and treatment, pay equity. They do a great job on the customer experience and customer satisfaction. So you can't look at any one thing in isolation.
I mentioned Jeff Bezos before. He comes in, Amazon's only number 30, and they're the top retailer in your group. What happened there?
So they'll probably move up again next year. Remember, our rankings are through May 31, and then when they went to the $15 minimum wage, that was after that fact, and that'll definitely be a real positive for them next year. Retail, I'm really excited about because you've had Target, you've had Walmart, you've had Amazon all increase their basic minimum level, basic minimum wages that they're paying across the board. And see, that's what's so great, I think, about these rankings. These really are a competition for goodness. I'll give you a great example. Microsoft, why is Microsoft number one? They have 100% compliance on pay equity, meaning they go through and do a survey and they make sure that their women are paid just as much as their men are. And so it's funny, I have a small business. Has CNBC ever conducted a pay equity survey?
I don't know the
okay,
answer.
Okay, so 39 out of the top 100 just companies have conducted a pay equity survey. And it's interesting because until I got into this, I have a small business. I never would have thought about it.
Do you do a pay equity survey here?
I just got finished asking our HR. She goes, well, we've been doing this for 4 years, but we've never actually conducted a formal survey. And I said, well, maybe we should. She goes, well, we're not like a large corporation that probably has tens of thousands of employees. We've got 380. I think we're covered. But the point is, the reason why this is so much more important than you talking about damn earnings all the time is because these best practices are what everyone, whether you're a public company or a private company, needs to do so we have a just workplace.
Let me throw another name at you. General Motors, I was surprised, came in 14. This was above Amazon, above Facebook, above these other bigger companies that we often talk about.
Great job on worker pay and treatment. Fantastic job on worker, great customer experience.
They just laid off 14,000 people.
That again happened after May 31. That will have an impact in next year's rankings, right? So these are as of May 31. So the only thing that I would say is what we're trying to do here is to take the message that's really, to me, most important, which is it's about the human side of what companies do. And we've got to make sure that in businesses, as well as when we're investing, that we don't look at companies just as these lifeless entities that do nothing but make profits, because we're not going to have a sustainable social structure. Capitalism will not survive unless we change.
Let me ask you about two other ones. One is Tesla. We're talking about automakers. In the bottom 10%. On this list. It basically doesn't even make the list.
Yeah. You know what? The way I look at that, look at the room for improvement he has next year, right? They don't do a great job on worker pay and treatment. If I was on the board of Tesla or if I was Elon Musk, that would really bother me. That would really bother me. And so hopefully I'd be focused on that, and I'd say I don't want to be there. I want to be.
So he's trying to avoid the unions right now.
Right.
He's actually saying he does pay his people well because he pays them in stock. Right. Okay. He's going to tell you that people on the floor get a lot of money. Could potentially make a lot of money given the stock, but how much of this, by the way, it deals with governance? I ask only because I don't know if you saw in 60 Minutes last night. He said he doesn't respect the SEC.
Right. So that particular bucket is about 7 or 8%. Again, remember, there's so many different issues that go into justice. It's not just one thing that makes or breaks or disqualifies you. It's the whole range of things.
How much do you want CEOs to look at this list, call you up and say, how can I get higher on the list? What do I have to do to move, and how do I have to reposition myself? And then the question is,
just hold on. They're not calling me. We polled the American public.
I assume that they call you and then say, okay, I need to understand the metrics with which you're using because I want to figure out how I can do better. But if the focus is on worker pay, for example, over making a killer product or delighting the consumer.
It's not black or white. Right. Remember, it's all shades of gray. So it's about worker paying treatment. It's about having a great customer experience. It's about having a socially beneficial product at a reasonable cost of great quality. It's about how do I treat my communities? It's about am I creating domestic jobs for American workers who need work?
But interestingly, we all want domestic jobs for American workers.
Correct.
We all want higher wages.
Right.
By the way, you care about macroeconomics more than anybody else. Look at what the Fed is thinking about the fact that wages are getting where they're getting. Think about how the market is reacting to that. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at this list and then you think about the reaction and you think what?
You mean with regard to the Fed?
With regard to the Fed, but even just more broadly, with regard to the way the stock market reacts when wages go higher. You'd think it, you'd think that actually they would, that companies or the stock or shareholders would effectively give you kudos for this, but they do the opposite.
Right.
For obvious reasons, by the way.
So it's really,
for obvious reasons.
It's really interesting, right? Jeff Bezos was probably the only CEO that could come in and say, I'm going to have a $15 minimum for every one of my employees. He's probably the only guy, because any person that was just kind of a hired contractor CEO is going to have a board and shareholders. They're going to absolutely eviscerate that person. But Jeff Bezos, you know, he is Amazon. So he, in his regal godlike way, could do the right thing, the beneficial thing. I guess, you know, the thing that I look at, when I look at the wealth disparity in this country, which I think's the biggest single threat we have, because it's a threat to the entire, our capitalist way of life, which is the best form of economic governance. We've got too many Americans left behind.
Right.
And so, I look at this almost like climate change. We know climate change is bringing impending doom and disaster, but it's happening incrementally, so we don't do anything about it. When I think about worker pay and going to $15, okay, you know what? So maybe it's going to cost a little bit in terms of ROE. But in the long run, if we don't do this, we're going to lose our whole form of capitalism. And so I think we've got to, I think, as Americans, as shareholders, as any stakeholder, we've got to realize there has to be a better balance. There has to be a better balance in the way we divide corporate revenue between shareholders as well as workers, customers, communities, and the planet.
Right.
It's out of whack, and we've got to change it.
I also wanted to talk to you about what I think is a relatively bold call that you have about what the Fed may or may not do when it comes to hikes. What do you think is going to happen?
Well, central banks always, generally speaking, manage by looking in a rearview mirror. So they're always looking at data that's old. The whole forward guidance thing locks them into these kind of intractable paths that's very difficult for them to deviate from. And that's probably not the best way to manage an economy, but it's when you're driving that many different stakeholders and you have so much momentum, it's very hard for them to change. What's different this time is that I started out as a cotton trader, so commodities, you know, I was trading, that was the very first thing. There were no financial futures or there's certainly no stock index futures when I first started, and other financial futures on interest rates had just begun. My point being, I always look at commodities because they're a great leading indicator for the economy. So right now we have the Goldman Sachs Commodity Index down about 15% over the past 40 days. Never in the history of the Fed have we had that kind of a deflationary impulse 8 days before a hike. So just within the last 2 months, we've got this incoming data, and we had this, what I think is the bellwether of the economy, telling us
there's a problem here.
There potentially a problem, right? And the real question is it supply-driven or is it demand-driven? It's demand-driven. Oh, my God. Like, it's funny. If you just kind of go query up, Goldman Sachs Commodity Index is down 15% over the past 40 days, and you go just look at those times through history, you find that it typically is happening during cutting cycles, not hiking cycles. So this is different this time. We are hiking with this really contemporaneous set of very important data telling you, watch it, because you could be hiking exactly the time you should be cutting. So And if I just, the only other times we've even been close to this was 74. I think the GSCI was down 11%, 97, and then December of 2015. So in 74, that was they hiked us right into a recession. In 97, that was one hike before we ended up getting into 98 and all the problems associated with that. And then in 2015, that was the first hike. Right. We went to 50 basis points, and we were on pause for years. So the one thing that I would say is there's a high probability that this hike will be, assuming they hike, will be one for the last one for a long time.
So you don't think they're going to hike in 2019?
No. I don't think they're going to hike in 2019.
Really? I
mean, no.
But by the way, the market still expects them to hike in 2019.
There's 20 basis points. It's not that much priced in. But I don't think they're going to hike, no.
What do you think the chances are they don't hike in a week?
Oh, I think they'll probably hike. Again, there's so much momentum. And central bankers, by definition, are so conservative. And for them to change that quickly would require this unbelievable change. Right. The mindset. And look, you know, so on the one hand, we've got this fact set that we've never seen before, hiking into clear deflationary signals coming from the commodity complex. So let's say, okay, I don't think they're going to hike in 2019. So now let's look and say, what happens if this is the last hike? What happens?
Are we off to the races?
Well, so we've got three episodes to look at. We've got the end of the, when I say episodes, long hiking cycles, so I throw out 97, long hiking cycles followed by a termination point. So that gives us 95, that gives us 2000, 2006. So those are the last three modern day hiking cycles. And when they ended, they were generally speaking great times to buy the stock market. Within a month or so, the stock market was off the races.
Right.
So we've got, if you just thought, okay, this is going to be like last time, you'd want to be thinking about, in this turbulent period, buying stocks, because history would say 95 we exploded, 2000 we at least went back and retested the highs. I think they stopped in May or June, and we were back and retesting the highs in October. And then in 2006, we went on for another 20-25%. Right. We went all the way up until October 2007. So modern day history would say, if this is the end, we've got to get ready for a big rally.
So
this
is your
year.
Gang that's behind me and around us, are they positioning themselves? Are you guys buying right now amidst all of this?
Well, and again, on the other side,
okay,
all of a sudden we've got them hiking into this deflationary impulse, which, if you remember December 2015, we had that horrific January of 2016, 74, we got annihilated. Even 97 after they hiked, we went down. So you've got kind of two, if I'm just looking
right
for historical analogs, I've got...
So which one are you betting on, though?
Well, that's why I said I think 10 up, 10 down. We're going to be both sides, because I don't necessarily know just
yet. But then what do you do about it if you're going to be 10 up or 10 down?
Well,
you just play the volatility.
I'm going to buy the hell out of it 10 lower for sure. To me, that's an absolute layup. The difference between now and, say, December 2015 is the market's deleveraged so much, right? We probably, if you think about all the buybacks, which we're going to have next year, which is, I can't imagine that sometime next year we won't be up 10% in the year, 10 or 15% in the year. I can't imagine because
right,
we still have the same buybacks we had this past year. The difference is we're walking in to next year completely, totally deleveraged. And so, I mean, right, if we're being honest, you know, markets a lot of times it's just about herding cattle.
But you've
back
also
and
talked
forth
about the whole system being overleveraged, talking about deleveraged.
Yes.
So again,
that's why I think we can be both sides. We probably are sitting on a big global credit bubble,
right,
and I hope I'm not underestimating the potential negative impact that popping that bubble. What's so interesting about this hike is that this one, you're seeing the problems coming from it or the consequences of it. You're seeing it where the bubble's the greatest. You're seeing it in China domestically on the private right. side. You're seeing it in Italy, who has a credit bubble in terms of their right. their public deficits, their public debt. So we're seeing this hike playing out in the areas of the greatest credit right. vulnerability, the biggest bubbles.
We got to run, but I'm going to hit two things. Real quick, China trade. How much do you think that's impacting the market?
I'd say there's an emotional aspect of it that had a huge impact, no doubt about it. And clearly it's had an impact domestically in China and popping their credit bubble, right. which is having ramifications. So, yeah, it's a big deal. I'd say 50 China, 50 the Fed.